good morning. So this is the first one of a series of lectures that are going to be recorded for as a part of a kind of SIMPA course that are going to be recorded here in this beautiful place, Nesim Mathematical Village. And the purpose is to introduce some topics in complex analysis. Not also the basic topics, but some perhaps more advanced topics, so the course will be more suitable for people already having already some background on complex analysis. But nevertheless, in the first lessons, in the first, let's say, seven, perhaps something like these lessons, I will review the basics of complex analysis, mostly without proofs. But I will give the main ideas of what are holomorphic functions, analytic functions, meromorphic functions, residues, and the main topics about it. And after that, I will continue with more perhaps specialized topics, like I will speak about conformal mappings, infinite products, the Gamman zeta functions, and elliptic functions. It's more or less the idea of the topics I will cover in this course. Okay. For the first lessons, let's say the basics of complex analysis, there are many reference books, but one of them that I find especially suitable for this kind of course is the book of Asch and Nobinger. The title is Complex Functions or Complex Analysis. I review the title exactly. It's complex variables. Complex variables. And you can find not only because it's quite suitable for this course, but you can find it free in the web page of Asch. He has a copy, so everyone can download it legally, let's say, and profit out of it. So it's a quite convenient textbook for most of the topics I will explain in the course, but especially for the first lessons, I will follow that book more or less, essentially more or less. But there are many books in complex analysis, so any good book may be appropriate for these lessons. For instance, I can mention some other ones, and Conway, the book of Conway, John Conway, Functions of One Complex Variable. Perhaps it's not so good for the basics, in my personal opinion, but after that, this book covers a lot of subjects, so it's, it can be interesting also for the course. But many books are also you can find in any library many books on complex analysis, and if you look in internet, you can find many good notes on complex analysis. So any one of them would be appropriate for the course. And after that, for the besides these basics on complex analysis, when I begin with the more, let's say, advanced topics, I will prepare some notes. So some notes will be available, they are not still available, but at the moment I think these lectures will be uploaded and they will be available for everyone. I think the notes will be available in that moment. Okay? So let's begin with the basics. Let's begin with thing with what is a holomorphic function. Which is the main object I will try to study in this course. Okay? So C will be considered as a topological space, as R2, of course, as usual. It's only a review of the main notions. Normally, I will call Z or perhaps W the variable, the complex variable in C. That is something like this. So X will be called, as usual, the real part, of course, and Y the imaginary part. So in some sense, you can identify any set, any subset of R2, and you can identify with a subset on C with this identification xy to the variable z. I will do it. This is only to fix some notations. I will do it without saying anything. Okay. So consider in C an open set U, for instance, and a point in Z, in U, and a point called Z0. And assume that you have a function f defined on U with values in C. These are the main objects we will study here, that are complex functions, of course. So we will say that this function is holomorphic. Holomorphic. At z0 if it's derivable, differentiable in the usual sense. So if it exists, this limit we'll say that the function is holomorphic at z0, and this limit is called, as usual, the derivative of f at z0. So it's as you probably know, as everyone knows, everyone who has followed the course in real variables, this is the usual definition of derivative in for real functions also, okay? But here it's for complex functions, okay? Holomorphic at z0. Of course, if it's holomorphic at every point in U, I will call simply that the function is holomorphic in U. And normally I will denote like this, O of U, the set of holomorphic functions in U. It will be called, will be denoted O of U. As I told before, I will not provide the whole proofs of every statement I will say in these basics, but the main ideas are going to be the same as in real variables. For instance, if you have two functions that are holomorphic, of course both the sum or the product, etc., all these combinations are also holomorphic. Okay, if a function is holomorphic at a point, z0, it is continuous. It's continuous at that point, as usual in the real context, and the chain rule also is verified here. So if you have a function f and another function g, you have a function f that goes from here to here, say from u to v, and another function g here, and both are holomorphic. Let's say we have a point here z0, its image here is w0, and f is holomorphic at z0, g is holomorphic at w0, of course the composition is holomorphic at z0. Okay, and the usual chain rules each number would be the derivative of the composition. The proof is essentially the same as in one variable, so I will not going to provide it here. Okay, I'm going to say a little bit about the relation of being holomorphic and being differentiable in the real sense. Okay? So, for instance, let's say, assume you have a function f, as before, and the point z0 in U, where f is holomorphic. Okay, for a function f identifying U with an open set in R2 with variables xy, course, you can write the function f as the real part taking, defined in, as a function in two variables, plus the imaginary part, I plus the imaginary part. U and v are the real and imaginary part, respectively, of the function f, considered as functions, and real functions now. So u and v are real functions from R2, from an open set in R2 to R. Okay? So what is the relation between being f holomorphic and being u and v being, let's say, for instance, differentiable or continuously differentiable, something like this. Okay? So assume we you have this point f, this point z0, where if f is holomorphic, and assume I want to rewrite the definition of holomorphy in quite in a slightly different way. Assume you consider the function epsilon of h defined as follows: f of z0 minus f of z0 plus h minus f z zero. Zero if h is different from zero, and zero if h is equal to zero. This is a function of h. So this function verifies that the limit when h tends to zero is zero. That is a value of a zero. So the definition of holomorphy can be written also like this. Plus, where epsilon of h is a function that tends to zero. So this is the usual definition normally of the differentiability. What happens if we take real and imaginary parts in this expression? For instance, for let's call lambda this number here and write lambda as lambda 1 plus I lambda 2. Okay? And take real and imaginary parts in this expression. So if I take the real part, I will have something like this: u of, I'm going to write x0, the point z0 is going to be x0, y0, x0 plus h1, y0 plus h2 is equal to u x0, y0 plus the real part here would be real times real minus imaginary times imaginary, so lambda 1 h1 minus lambda 2 h2, let's say, where h is h1 plus I h2, plus the real part of this. I don't care too much about it. But it's something that tends to zero more quickly than h, in some sense. Okay? And the same with the imaginary part. Plus lambda 1 h2 plus lambda 2 h1 plus imaginary part of this expression. Okay? So this is the real, this is the usual expression of differentials. So in that sense, and this is h1 here, in this sense, lambda 1 would be. But the first expression means that u is differentiable at that point as a real two-variable function, and v is differentiable at that point as a real two-function variable. And lambda 1 turns out to be the part, the partial derivative of u with respect to x at this point. And minus lambda 2 would be the imaginary part. The derivative of the, sorry, of v of u with respect to y And from the second expression, you have that this lambda 1 must be the derivative of v, which is the partial derivative with respect to y, and lambda 2 would be the derivative with respect to x. So we find some relations. So u and v cannot be simply any two real differentiable functions, but because they have to fulfill this relation. For instance, this number must be the same as this number, and this number must be the opposite of this number. So let us resume this, both these two facts, saying that if a function f is holomorphic, f is holomorphic at z0, we have the following facts. We have that the partial derivative of the real part with respect to x must be equal to partial derivative of the imaginary part with respect to y. And the partial derivative of u with respect to y must be the partial derivative of u of v with respect to x. Okay, these two relations must be verified for a complex function. These two relations are called Cauchy-Riemann equations or Cauchy-Riemann relations. So, if we have a holomorphic function, both real and imaginary parts must be real differentiable, of course, and these real and imaginary parts must fulfill these two relations among the derivatives. What is important is the converse is also true. The converse is true. Converse is true. I mean, if we have, imagine you have any complex function written like this, u plus iv, defined on an open set u. You don't know anything about this function, but you know that. What I want to say that the following are equivalent for this function. The following are equivalent. First, this function f is holomorphic at z0. F is holomorphic. And second, the real and imaginary parts are differentiable. Differentiable. And they satisfy Cauchy-Riemann equations. So the partial derivative of u with respect to x must be the partial derivative of v with respect to y, and the partial derivative of u with respect to y is minus the partial derivative of v with respect to x. These are equivalent. Okay? Well, I'm not going to show the converse, but it's not complicated to show. But as I told before, in the book of Ash, for instance, you can find all the proofs, and in these first lessons I will not provide, I will only give the main ideas about the basics on complex analysis. Okay. From this simple relation, some properties can be easily deduced. For instance, I'm going to write over there. For instance, assume that you have a function u to z, a holomorphic function but such the images are always real. For instance, let's say that such that for if every z, f of z is real. For instance, what can we say about this function? What can we say about this? Assume that U is connected. Also, it's a connected open set. So we can we deduce? Well, in this case, if f is always, if the function always takes real values, writing f as u plus I v, v must be zero. Of course, it must be zero if it takes only real values. So if v is zero, if v is the function that is zero everywhere, using Cauchy-Riemann relations, the partial derivatives of v are zero, so the partial derivatives of u are also zero. So partial derivative of u with respect to x is identically zero. So u is constant because the domain is connected. So u is constant. So a function taking only real values, a holomorphic function taking only real values, must be constant. Okay? Must be always constant. As we will say along the course, holomorphic functions satisfy sometimes very strong relations. So we will see many results stating that if a holomorphic function satisfies certain not very complicated properties, it is constant automatically. Well, in this case, it's not so surprising, but we'll see that there are many results in this in the same line. Okay, some condition that guarantees the function is constant. Well, of course, the same would be true if assuming that a function takes only purely imaginary values. In that case, u is zero, and Cauchy-Riemann relations says that v must be zero, that the derivatives, the partial derivatives of v must be zero, and v in that case is constant. Okay, but some more things can be said. For instance, assume, I don't want to erase for a moment. Assume, for instance, that you have also a holomorphic function defined in a, as before, in a connected open set, and assume that the modulus of f is constant. So the modulus of the complex number f of z is always a constant c. Okay, well, of course, if c is zero, nothing to say. If c is zero, the function f is identically zero, and everything is finished. But in general, consider the square of a modulus. In this case, the square is f times the conjugate of f. Conjugate of f would be the function defined by u minus I v. So this is c square, and you can write like this. As I told before, holomorphic functions verify the same properties as usual real functions, in the for instance, algebraic properties, in the sense that sums, products, quotients of holomorphic functions are also holomorphic. So if f is holomorphic, the conjugate of f due to this relation must be holomorphic. Okay, if f and the conjugate of f are holomorphic, the sum is holomorphic, but the sum is two times the real part. So if it is holomorphic and takes real, only real values, it's constant. And of course, the same happens with the difference, okay, that is 2i imaginary part of f. So the difference is also constant, okay? So we arrive to the conclusion that f is constant. Also from here. So a function, a holomorphic function such that the modulus is constant must be necessarily constant. Also, so this is very simple relation that come out easily from Cauchy-Riemann equation. Okay, very simple conditions allow to say that some functions are constant. Okay, and well, about the basics, not too much to say. Of course, all usual functions of that you use in a you use in the real context, you have the translations in the complex constant. For instance, you can define, of course, as holomorphic functions, you can have the functions Zn, the powers, of course, any polynomials, of course, the exponential is going to play a very important role. How, even if it's very well known, but I want to recall very quickly, how do you define the exponential of a complex number? If a complex number z is has a modulus and an argument, so can be written like this. Okay, or better, I'm going to write like this, as a real imaginary part. This is, and this is, can be defined as so in this sense you define the exponential of any complex number. We can verify, as an example here, the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Here, u of xy must be this function, and v must be this function here. So Cauchy-Riemann equations said that the partial derivative of u with respect to x. Here, the partial derivative of u with respect to x is, in the real sense, is e to the x cosinus y, and the partial derivative of v with respect to y is e to the x, the derivative of sinus is cosinus. So the first relation is fulfilled, and the second, the partial derivative of u with respect to y, with respect to y, is minus e to the x sinus y. Sorry, but in Spain sinus is named seno, so I tend to write sen instead of sin. So it's sinus of y, and partial derivative of u of v with respect to x is e to the x sinus of y. So they are opposite in sign. So Cauchy-Riemann equations are verified. So the exponential is a holomorphic function everywhere, and of course it's a function that satisfies the usual properties of the exponential. I mean, the exponential is never zero for any complex number z, and the exponential satisfies the usual rule transforming sums in powers, And the derivative of the exponential is the exponential. As the most basic properties. Okay? Only something that I will emphasize after, the exponential does not take the value zero, but it takes any other complex value. I mean, in the real context, exponential takes only positive values, not here. Exponential can take any complex value except zero. Okay, for instance, it is well known that e to the I pi, here, if you apply this relation, e to the I pi, x must be zero, y is pi, so we have cosinus of pi is minus 1, sinus of pi is 0, so this is minus 1. But this is well known Euler's relation. And it's not too complicated to verify that the exponential assumes every complex value except 0. And this is always to be an important property of holomorphic functions, as we will say. I'm not sure if I will show it, but a holomorphic function defined in the whole complex plane must always take every complex value except at most one value. So it's one of the striking results I said before. I don't know if I will have time to see this result, but anyway, if you have a holomorphic function defined in the whole complex plane C, it must take every complex value except with at most one exception. So there are two values that the function does not take. The function must be constant automatically. For instance, this is a quite striking result. Okay, as I told before, there are many results in complex analysis that say something like this. If a function verifies these not so very complicated properties, it's constant. Okay, or if it does not verify this property. Okay, fine, trigonometric functions, etc. I'm not going to enter in too many details, but you can define the sinus of a complex number, the cosinus of a complex number. As usual, the sinus you can define like this. Okay, and the cosinus like this. So there are linear combinations of the compositions of the exponential, so automatically they are holomorphic. Okay, and usual functions that we use with real numbers can be defined for holomorphic functions with one exception that I will explain after. That is the logarithm. The logarithm is a complicated function. I will talk about it later. Why we must take some care with the logarithm? How can you define, for instance, the logarithm in the real sense, in the real context? You have the exponential, that is a bijective function between r and r plus. Okay, and you take the inverse. This is bijective, this is an increasing function. You take the inverse, and the inverse is verifies all good properties, and this is the logarithm. Okay, for a real number. But here the exponential is not injective. The exponential is not injective. Why? Exponential of 2 pi I is 1, for instance. Okay, so exponential is not injective. In fact, the exponential, one interesting property is the exponential is periodic. It's also an interesting property. The exponential is periodic, and the period is 2πi. 2πi. So we must take some care, because if you take a complex number, there are many numbers. Like, let's say, if you take a complex number, let's say different from zero, there always exists, of course, there always exists a number z zero such that. But there are many. There are many. We can restrict to, for instance, a band here. We could restrict zero to pi I to a band and try to find one here. Okay? And in this sense, you could define a logarithm. You must take some care about it. I will say some words about it later, about the logarithm, because it's an important function in the complex setting, but it always has some problems. For instance, it is not, if you define a logarithm in some band here, in some strip here, it is not clear that the logarithm of a product is the sum of the logarithm defined in this sense. Why? Because perhaps, let's say, in some sense there are many determinations of the logarithm. We have a determination taking the imaginary part here, but another determination taking the imaginary part here, etc. So it may happen that you have two points that the determination of the logarithm is here, but the determination of the product, when you sum, you find a point here. So you move to another determination of the logarithm. So for this, for that, you must take care with the logarithm. Okay, it's an important function, and we will say some words about it a little bit later. Anyway, okay. Well, these are more or less the basics about the basic definitions of holomorphic functions. And continuing about that, I'm going to begin speaking some about the integration. And this is going to play a very important role in all the theory. Integration along paths. Integration along paths. Okay? So, the idea is the following. Consider an open set U. U is an open set in C. Okay? So, and we are going to consider what paths. What is a path? A path is going to be a map from a real interval AB to U. We are going to assume that it's real differentiable, continuously differentiable. Actually, differentiable. I mean, if the path has two components, I mean, if gamma of t is x of t plus I y of t, okay, we assume that x of t and y of t are C1 functions in the real sense, the usual real sense, okay? So, no problem about it. At least, perhaps, we can enlarge a little bit our set of possible paths. At least we will assume that gamma is continuous, always continuous, and perhaps piecewise C1, and piecewise piecewise continuously differential. So you can split the domain, the interval, in several sub-intervals such that in each, the interior of each sub-interval, it is continually differential. This is only to allow paths, for instance, polygonal paths. polygonal path can be defined as a continuous, piecewise continuously differentiable. Okay. So this is what I'm going to call a path. Okay. As you surely know from the, well, it's one of the applications of the theory of real variable integral. When you have a continuously differentiable path, you can compute its length. And the length, in the real sense, if you have a path defined in R2, parameterized like this, where t taking values in a closed interval, the length, so this is a path, this is the point, the first point, the initial point, this is the end point, the length of this path you learn in the real variable lectures, that it can be computed as the integral from A to the real integral from A to B of the square root of this is the usual formula that can be deduced in real variable context for the length of a path. You arrive to this formula in the, normally taking some polygonals here, take the sum of these segments, and you take a limit. And the limit is going to be a Riemann sum, and the Riemann sum when the let's say this the number of these segments tends to infinity, or the length tends to zero, length of each segment tends to this integral. Okay, well, this is the usual proof in the, so in this context if we have a path, a complex path defined like this, denote gamma of t x gamma prime of t x prime of t plus I y prime of t. This is not a holomorphic function, this is a function defined on a real interval. Okay, if you define here, this length can be computed as this number is exactly the modulus of the derivative, okay, in this complex setting. So this is the length. This is one of the main notions associated to a path. Okay, we have that. And we call sometimes a loop a closed path. A closed path. Shall be called a loop. Sometimes. A closed path, I mean, where the initial and the end points are the same. The one of the most usual examples of loops of closed path will be the circles. Okay? So a circle center in Z0 of radius R will be parameterized normally as Z0 plus R IT, where, for instance, where T in this case goes from 0 to 2 pi. Okay, this is the most usual, perhaps, example of loop. Of loop that we are going to use it very often in these lectures. Okay? So we are going to define the notion of integration along path of a function. And more or less this will be approximately the end of this first session. So assume you have an open set U and let's say continuous function. Assume f is only continuous. It's not necessary to assume now that it's holomorphic, if continuous. And assume you have a path, gamma, is a path on U. Sometimes we will call gamma star the image. I mean the set of this line. Okay, gamma. You know, it's not exactly the same. The path, as I have defined it, is an application, and the gamma star, the path with the geometrical path, it's a line, let's say. But it can be parameterized in many different ways, of course. But assume something like this. So f continuous and gamma a path. So define the integral. How do you define integration? The integral of a function f along this path is defined as the integral from a to b of f of gamma t times gamma prime t dt. Some explanation about this expression. This is a complex number and this is a complex number. So this is a product of complex numbers, so it has real and imaginary parts. And if I have a complex function, I mean xy plus I of t plus I of t, by this I mean to integrate, as usual, the real and imaginary parts separately. Okay, so integrate in this sense, and you define the integration along a path. This integration verifies some properties. I'm only going to state now, and to finish this first session, some basic properties that are the following. For instance, you can reparameterize a path. A path can be parameters like this, or can be reparameterized in another, for instance, a path we have here, a map here, but you can compose, for instance, with something like this, a bijective map here, let's say H. You can take a bijective increasing, strictly increasing map that takes C to A and D to B. Well, this is called this composition is called a reparametrization of the path. The drawing is exactly the same. Simply, it is defined in a different. You go through the path at a different speed, in some sense. Okay. Well, so you have a path gamma and a path gamma composed by H that are the same drawing with the same initial and the same endpoint. Let's call it gamma one. Okay. If you have a continuous function defined on U, the integrals, as I defined before, the integral of f along gamma and along gamma one are the same. So the integral is independent of the reparametrization of the path. Okay? And if you take an inverse parametrization, so you can reparametrize but in a different way. So if you take, you compose by h but reversing the order, I mean h of c equal b, h of d equal a, with h strictly decreasing, it corresponds to go, instead from going to this initial point to the end point, you go in the opposite sense. Okay, so the integral changes the sign. In this case, called gamma 1, as before, this one. So the integral, well, these are very easy properties to verify only very simple properties of the integral, and you can verify that these properties are verified. Okay, so I will stop here this first session. Thank you.